Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strawstown Rod and Gun Club.
Phillies are 2008 World Champions of Baseball.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Just Say Sports. My name is Rob Galtere on the greatest week of the entire year for everything. Last night was Christmas Eve for me. It's when it's Election Sunday, that is my Christmas Eve. With me, the usuals, Todd Haines, Chris Barto. Gentlemen, welcome. A lot to talk about. We'll go through some of our picks for the NCAA tournament. But most importantly, the Phillies got off their butts and signed an actual starting pitcher. Now they got two. So they're going to go two-man rotation and probably win 90, 95 games. What do you think about the area to signing?
Well, you know, I mean, how can you not like it? I mean, we were talking last week, they had to do something because, you know, he's running Nola out there. They named him the opening day starter, you know, one day in the camp, because that's all they really had. I'd still love to see them get a left-handed pitcher, though, because he can't run five right-handed starting pitchers. You're just going to run into a team that's left-handed dominant bat-wise and just kill you. So I still like to see a left. But getting Arrieta is a good start. They had the money. I'm kind of surprised that, you know, he came to Philadelphia, because I guess he sees up and coming, or I don't understand. Like, there wasn't a market for him.
Or they were the only ones who offered money.
Yeah, it's, I don't understand that, so...
I would say good move, hopefully great move. What I did read about was the Orioles' connection with Arrieta and the Phillies' front office. That's how they were familiar with each other, I believe. And I think the contract's excellent, the way it's structured. Mm-hmm. 3 years at the longest, unless the Phillies want to make it a 5-year, and two if Arrieta only wants it to be two.
And front-loaded, mm-hmm. you know, with that $30 million up front. And he did work out with Nick Williams. I remember reading that like a month ago that, you know, Nick Williams was saying, Arrieta wants to come here. Let's pay him. You know?
Well, he's a big health nut, too, and he fits right in for the new manager who's a little bit gung-ho. Yeah. Let's say gung-ho on the workout regimes, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a fantastic pickup, I think. Just want to let the home viewers know tonight, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to take callers, just some technical difficulties here at the studio, so we apologize for that, and hopefully that'll be fixed for our next program. Again, just want to touch on some other things. Is Tiger back? Tiger looked great yesterday, this weekend, he just looked different the way he was carrying himself.
Yeah, I mean, he made putts that he had to make, you know, those 10 to 15 footers for par that he, you know, for the last few years he's missed and just buried himself. But he was making them, and, you know, he had that swagger. He's hitting the stinger that, that few people can hit besides him and myself. But, you know, he was back to hitting that famous Tiger stinger.
We call those Haines.
Yeah.
Your stingers.
Yeah, I don't mean to keep it low. He does somehow. But now he's back to hitting his normal shots, and I mean, he gets that one putt to drop for eagle, and all of a sudden he's tied for the lead, and it's like, wow. After, you know, crowds are crazy. It was, I didn't turn it off even with basketball. I just couldn't stop watching. It was like early 2000s television.
Was it must watch again just because Tiger's in it?
I did see a decent amount of it, and he played well, obviously. The one thought I had, will he be willing to hit the irons off the tee down the road?
Yeah.
Or will he fall in love with the driver again and start spraying it? Wow. That's going to be the key. He's got to keep it in play and hit greens in regulation and putt well.
And that's what he did. especially that final round. I mean, it's been a long time to see Tiger be able to down the stretch, put the ball in play, put it on the green, and then go after some putts. So that was definitely kind of...
His short game around the greens all week, chips. I mean, he was getting them to 2 feet.
And I thought the highlight for me was the 2-iron on the par 5, where he just smoked a 2-iron right up the hill. And you just knew if he had that much confidence and his back is fine. He's not even thinking about it for him to unleash a 2-iron like that. So that was definitely cool. Eagles pick up Michael Bennett. Kind of a shock, actually. I think it's a pretty good move if you're going to have to get rid of any Curry. It gives you some... gives you some depth there, but kind of a surprise.
Yeah, it just shows, I guess, how he's going all in for next year, too. You know, so it was shocking. It was like, you know, I didn't think we needed him, but now you hear that Curry's probably out, and so for the other Brandon Graham's contract's coming up soon, but I think he'll get a new one. But yeah, I mean, you know, I'd say a third down is going to be to move Brandon Graham inside next to, or put Bennett inside.
I think they're
going
to move Bennett inside.
Yeah, next to Cox.
Because Jernigan and Bo Allen had to be two of the worst pass rushers I've seen as tackles.
Interesting, considering the cap problems they have. I guess he doesn't have a huge salary, but acquiring a 32-year-old, you know, obviously he's been good in the past, but... I think what they're hoping is the much less time on field will help his production.
And that's
sort of like what they did with Chris Long.
Yeah, and I think that's their plan, to constantly have four defensive linemen. So the other trade they make, I don't quite figure out what Carolina's doing, because the Eagles were going to release Torrey Smith. I assume they were going to release Torrey Smith.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they got a somewhat productive cornerback. It's a guy you could throw out there, and if you end up trading Darby, you've got another guy in the running for that position. So
yeah, it seems like that's the move, next move, to move Darby to get a third round pick, if somebody will give you a third round pick for Darby, because now you have Mills, Sidney Jones, the new kid, I don't even remember his name, to be honest with you, but the kid they just picked up from Carolina.
Yeah, Worley.
Yeah. And, you know, and then it sounds like they're going to want to bring Peterson.
And they got West of West Virginia, Russell Douglas.
Russell Douglas, and they look like they're going to bring Patrick Peterson back.
I wish they were bringing Patrick.
Not Patrick Peterson.
Robinson.
Patrick Robinson. But I'll take Peterson.
Yeah, well, he is Howie Roseman. Yeah, he's been known to do some crazy.
For an eighth round pick and somebody.
Can never have too much depth.
No. So where's your boy end up, Kirk Cousins?
Well, I saw that Minnesota was going to throw out a big 3-year offer, and I just read late today that the Cardinals plan on making a huge offer. So, good riddance.
Yeah, for a under 500 quarterback?
26-30-1 career record.
And he's going to get over $20 million a year. Yeah, Nick Foles has got to be licking his chops, just waiting for free agency in a year.
Yeah,
because those are some big numbers. Okay, that was the world of sports. Now let's get to the good part. This is where Haines shows he embarrasses himself sometimes with his basketball knowledge. But we won't laugh too hard.
Not tonight. I've got sheets.
He's got sheets.
I've
okay.
got notes, pens.
Let's start the top left, the South, with number one overall, Virginia. Obviously, we're just going to say they cruise by. Creighton, Kansas State. Anything interesting there? I mean, that's where Marcus Foster transferred from, Kansas State.
Yeah, I mean, this looks like the easiest bracket of the four so far. I mean, Cincinnati is the two. You know,
everyone's jumping on the Kentucky-Arizona, how unfair that is for Virginia. Well, but then you look at the KenPom, and they're 19-21 or 18-21. They should both be five seeds.
Yeah, Kentucky's been hot though. They ran through the SEC tournament pretty good, so that's why everybody jumps on them. But you know, they're young, and if you can get them rattled in a one-and-done game. You know, you never know what can happen in the second half. So.
Okay, looking at that South, any upsets first-round double-digit seed that you have?
How about the Hurricanes? Do they get by Loyola?
That's mine. I got Loyola Chicago Sweet 16. Very efficient offensively. They play great defense. And I don't know what to say about that implosion in the ACC tournament. Is that going to hurt or help a young team? A young team like Miami. I just can't get over their offense. The stagnation. The
seems standard.
Too much dribbling.
One-on-one. Constantly. No, I really like Loyola Chicago. Who do you have if it's Kentucky, Arizona?
My first one, I picked Kentucky.
Yeah. Also. Although Arizona's playing ever since the whole scandal and he's come back.
Us against the world.
Yeah, they have that mentality. It's like, well, all right, we'll show you. We're going to just go out and.
Yeah, but they still only beat UCLA in overtime.
Yeah. I would lean Kentucky if you forced me to make a pick there. So.
I mean, Kentucky did play well. It's tough to get that bitter taste out of your mouth how terrible they were during the year, lack of effort. And So at least they've got that lack of effort figured out. I think they're really going to struggle with Davidson. Davidson is a super hot team in the first round. They pass the ball so well. They always have four guys on the court who can shoot threes. They could spread Kentucky out. Vegas seems to agree it's only a 6-point spread, so yeah. I think that's a.
You know, and Davidson every year plays Duke and North Carolina, so they're not going to be.
No, they're not.
They're not going to be like, oh, look, it's Kentucky now.
No,
they play the big boys, so.
No, so and they just came off beating two NCAA tournament teams, Rhode Island and St. Bonaventure, two at-large teams. So I think that would be a game to consider. Let's go down before we won't run it all the way down. Let's go down to the West. Where Xavier's the one seed, Caroline is the two seed. Any upsets that you see in that region?
I really feel strongly that Ohio State may lose in the first round and certainly will not get past Gonzaga.
Yeah, everybody's big, I guess. You know, Michigan, you know, that's a Michigan UNC. Nothing I really see here jumps out at me. I don't think Xavier's going to make it to the Final Four. I think this is.
Did I get that far yet? Follow the pattern here.
I'm just giving you thoughts on the whole bracket. That this, the first one was the easiest bracket. This one's the weakest one, I believe.
You think this is the weakest? If there was an upset,
weakest one seed is here.
South Dakota State, another team that shoots really well. Mm-hmm. They've got a lot of experience. Love seniors on the team, and you just don't know with Ohio State. The only thing, Chris Holtman is the coach, and Baylor or Butler never lost. Mm-hmm. In the first round with him in close games.
Well, that 5-12 stat is the last 9 years, the 5-12 game is 18-18 straight up.
So you got to figure at least two, make sense that two.
Does Providence, they have anything left, or do they spend it all in the Big East tournament?
That's a good question. Yeah, you figure they wouldn't have anything left to play in the finals.
Right, because they have three overtime games. I guess their last three games are all overtimes.
All overtime games, and then they come back. Do they play on Thursday, I still believe? I think they
Friday.
Do they play Friday? Yeah. So at least they have that extra day. And A&M, when I saw them earlier in the year against Penn State, I thought they were one of the best teams in the country. And they just, now they've been banged up at guard, but.
In November and December, they were really good.
They were really good.
And I guess fell off the cliff.
Yeah, so that's a good first round game. Providence always plays good first round games. Last year they had the thriller with USC. The year before the USC game, they played them back to back years, come to think of it. And last year, I believe Carolina knocked out Providence. Or was it 2 years ago, Carolina knocked out Providence? That's what it was in that second round. So that could be another rematch. Heading into that, let's pick some Sweet 16 there. Does Xavier make it? You say they get knocked out earlier, or they make it to Sweet 16?
I think they might get knocked out before the Sweet 16.
Who would that be, Missouri or Florida State? Michael Porter back for Missouri.
Yeah, I kind of like the Florida State, that mid-ACC team. I mean, when I look at it, I try and see, you know, you put Xavier into the ACC, where would they finish? Would they be like a Florida State in the ACC, that kind of, you know, well, that you kind know, of record, that kind of, you know.
You know, Florida, what was Florida State, a two seed last year?
Yeah, two,
I think,
three,
yeah,
three.
And Xavier beat him by about 25 in the tournament, so that would be a rematch game.
Yeah.
Something to look at.
I have Xavier beating Missouri to get there.
Yeah, Sweet 16. Yeah. Gonzaga.
Yes. Michigan and Carolina.
Michigan and Carolina. Okay, let's go over to the East. Well, we're, of course, we'll move Villanova over because they're Villanova. Bama, Virginia Tech, very good, interesting game. Colin Sexton.
He's been on fire.
I'm already putting down, I want him to replace T.J. McConnell in that second second lineup for the Sixers.
Not T.J.
Yeah, I've had enough of T.J.
Come on.
Yeah, it's just not working for me anymore. The novelty is... any upsets in that bracket that you see? First round upset.
Butler over Arkansas? Would you consider that an upset? Or
10-7, I mean.
Yeah. Murray State, West Virginia, but...
Not for me.
Murray State's a good team.
Yeah.
And West Virginia...
You know, they're tied again with Kansas with 4 minutes to go in the Big 12 title game, so.
You know, it's crazy, and about that, West Virginia favored at Kansas. It was played in Kansas City, and West Virginia was favored going into that game, yet there are five,
and West Kansas Virginia has a horrible habit of blowing leads.
Right, right. So. I think UCLA can come out of that. They have a shot of reaching the Sweet 16. I think they'll beat St. Bonaventure, and I think they'll beat Florida. And with Texas Tech, I think that would be a good matchup. I still would have Texas Tech there. I assume being the ACC guy, Nova's getting eliminated second round?
Probably. I mean, they'll struggle in that first round game against either LIU, Brooklyn, or Radford.
With a straight face.
I just found out Radford's from Virginia earlier today. So I do like this Villanova team. This is, you know, I know they have a habit of getting bumped in the first weekend.
They either win national championships or they get bumped in the first weekend.
So they're either going to see West Virginia or Wichita State. You know, they'll get through the second round fine. Make it this week 16. So,
can anybody take down Purdue in the bottom?
I have Texas Tech beating them in the Sweet 16.
I think they're athletic enough to beat them. They can cover the shooters. Haas is always a pain. Mm-hmm. And they're not a real big team, but Villanova was tiny last year and beat Purdue at Purdue, even though Haas had about 26. Mm-hmm. They had no way to stop them. Okay, let's go down to the Midwest before we swing around and take some picks there.
Duke.
He's the number two seed in the region.
Yeah. Now, this is a nasty region, though.
How do you say this is a nasty region?
Well, you have Auburn as the four seed.
Kansas is by far the worst one seed.
Auburn was the regular season champ of the SEC.
Yeah, the team that lost to Alabama by 25, who's the nine seed up in the East.
You get Michigan State and Duke, who were both, you know, top five teams for a large portion of this year, and Kansas, who just won the Big 12 title.
In their home.
Basically on their home floor.
Basically on their home floor. Yeah, no, it's...
And Rhode Island, who was just in the...
It's pretty stacked. It's pretty stacked. Any upsets first round?
No.
I took New Mexico State.
Now, again, a 12 seed that's got a real opportunity.
I don't like Oklahoma at all, so no.
Second round upset. I'm taking Seton Hall over Kansas.
Really?
Seton Hall defends the three-point shot better than any team Villanova's played in the last 5 years. And this is Kansas with their four guards.
Right.
I just think, and they're all seniors. Well, three seniors, you know, with Carrington, Delgado, and Desi Rodriguez. So, I mean, it would definitely be an upset, but I think Seton Hall. And they're 26 on the Ken Pom. Kansas is like 9 Ken Pom.
Yeah.
So it's really not that much of a stretch.
I actually took TCU over Michigan State.
Did you?
I'm tired of hearing about how good Michigan State is. So,
I wanted to put Michigan State through, and they just so many games. They're trailing, and need a miracle push. And if it gets down to a good team like a TCU or Duke, you're not going to come back from
12 down to Duke. Mm-hmm. You're not going to, you know, against TCU, I'm not sure about that. Okay, let's go back up top. Take your Elite Eight. We got 4 minutes left. I've got Virginia and Cincinnati still.
Same for me.
Yep.
Okay, the West, Xavier and North Carolina for me.
Gonzaga, North Carolina.
I have Gonzaga, North Carolina as well.
Okay, you guys are wrong. The East, Villanova, Texas Tech?
Yes, for me.
Sure.
With conviction.
Yeah.
I have Auburn, Duke.
Really? Auburn, Duke?
Auburn then takes out Seton Hall. For me,
I have Kansas.
I have Clemson Duke, actually.
Do you really?
Yeah. I like the Clemson Duke.
Yeah, have you seen basketball outside of the ACC?
A little Big 12 here and there. I watched the Ivy League. Ken looked really good. Sold out yesterday. It was a fun game to watch.
Okay, your final four. I got Virginia playing North Carolina, Villanova playing Duke.
I have Virginia playing Gonzaga, Villanova, Duke.
It's a lot of ACC teams, but you're probably right. Yeah. You know, well, we sit here this whole time and analyze it. You know, Virginia gets bumped in the second round or something. Goofy happens.
So. You notice how you didn't say Duke gets bumped in the second round of Virginia? They obviously clear the best
Duke's
team.
Duke's not playing Lehigh this year, so we're good.
Yeah. Or, what was it? Not Belmont. It was Mercer.
Mercer.
Don't forget about Mercer. Of course, Villanova wins, and we knew that beforehand.
Sure.
Who do you have?
Villanova cuts down the nets.
Duke. Come on, Grayson.
Duke. I'll take Duke.
The big question is, will Grayson get thrown out of the tournament before they even get that far?
I don't know. He's
what
he's
will
close.
The next type of foul be? Elbow, headbutt?
Oh,
what's next?
He's obviously learned not to trip with his feet, so he's using his other body parts.
Right.
Interesting thing, just looking at this. Kansas playing... Penn, first round. I think it's got to be the lowest 116 point spread I've ever seen. It's at 14 right now.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of crazy how I'm not sure where the committee was going there when there are some 15 seeds, 14 seeds that aren't nearly as good as Penn. But
well, we saw Penn live and I didn't
think they were terrible that night.
Yeah, lost to Yale.
No, they beat Yale. In fact, because...
That night?
Because someone had Yale plus 5.5.
Yeah.
Wouldn't mention who.
You don't want to talk about TBS ruined? The brackets?
Okay, your fancy worksheet?
Yes.
Anything you want to throw out there? Oh, snubs. Everyone complains about Syracuse getting in. I didn't think they'd get in, but then looking back at it, I don't know who they should have put in.
Dick Vitale was really upset Oklahoma State didn't get in after they beat Kansas twice.
I have, you know, Middle Tennessee State. You talk mid-major, St. Mary's even.
Nah, St. Mary's didn't beat anybody. They didn't play anybody.
I'm not as upset about Syracuse as I am Oklahoma. You look at Oklahoma, they're 4-11 in their last 15 games. 4-11, I mean.
Yeah, that's terrible.
They only put him in because of one guy, I think.
Charles Barkley was hysterical with that. Where he said, well, their seed dropped. And he goes, well, where'd you have them at one? Two and ten in their last 12 games or whatever. Did you have them at one and just keep moving them back?
I mean, Jake Billis was going off last night. I was flipping back and forth between ESPN and TBS. And he was like, did anyone on the committee actually watch a basketball game this year? He was hot.
Yeah.
He was so upset with some of these seeds. And
well, it was fun teaching you guys some college basketball tonight.
Appreciate
good, good luck. Good luck with your brackets. We'll be seeing you this week. Having fun. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Thank you to the Straustown Rod and Gun Club for sponsoring this show, and we'll see you in a couple weeks on Just Say Sports.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Straustown Rod and Gun Club.